This time on Poll Hub, colds and flu have been a wintertime fact of life pretty much forever. But there's a new bug that's joined the club. It's called RSV. And fortunately, there's an effective vaccine for it. Unfortunately, relatively few Americans are getting it. Has the anti-vax sentiment that grew during COVID changed how Americans think about vaccines in general? Going to talk about that. Then, if you think staying up late and being into everything new is for the young, think again. New polling shows that members of Gen Z have some peculiar habits. So we're talking to our Gen Z producers to figure out what the heck's going on. Finally, what do you put on your slice? Some surprising results from a poll have us questioning who in the world would put that on a pizza? Lots to get to, so let's get to it. And hi, everybody. Welcome to Poll Hub. I'm J.D. Dapper.
I'm Barbara Carvalho.
I'm Mary Griffith.
I'm Athan Holland.
I'm Rebecca Hendricks.
And I am Lee Marigot.
And so as we mentioned at the top, this is cold and flu season. We all know it and hate it. But this is also the season for something relatively new we've been hearing about called RSV, or respiratory syncytial virus. Fortunately, as we mentioned in the open, there's a vaccine for this. Unfortunately, a lot of Americans aren't taking it. And we wanted to get into this because we've talked a lot about throughout the pandemic, we had a lot of public opinion research and a lot of data around vaccines and what people were doing to prevent getting or to lessen the impact of getting COVID when they got it. And a lot of the backstory in this has been about kind of a growing resistance or reluctance to get vaccines. And so we want to talk about this because it seems to be impacting RSV, a new vaccine that is very effective. And so we've got to get at, is this a trend that has caught on, or a problem, or a belief that has caught on? And what does that mean for public health? So we brought to the program Dr. William Schaffner. He is a professor of infectious diseases at Vanderbilt University School of Medicine down in Nashville. He's also past president of the National Foundation for Infectious Diseases. Dr. Schaffner, thanks for coming on.
Good to be with you.
So as we mentioned, RSV, there is an effective vaccine. The uptake for it, a couple of numbers. According to the CDC, as many as 80,000 children under five are hospitalized due to RSV, and between 100 to 300 kids die from it. For older folks over 65, 160,000 hospitalizations, between 6 and 10,000 deaths. But very few people, only 20% of those 60 or older have gotten the RSV shot. What is going on?
So let's talk a little bit about RSV, and then we'll address your question. RSV is another respiratory virus that's very similar to influenza. Every pediatrician and family doctor knows about RSV because, as you said, it has a big impact on the very young. It's the leading cause of death of very young children. It's only been recently understood, however, I would say in the last 15 years or so, that this virus can repeatedly cause infections throughout life. And indeed, when it starts hitting people age 60 and older, it can have an impact as serious as influenza does during its annual influenza season. So RSV is, we think, probably for older persons, as important in terms of hospitalizations and approaches its the importance of influenza in deaths. So this has only been recently appreciated. It's rather new news, not only to the general population, those people age 60 and older, but also to many medical practitioners, because when they went to medical school, they learned that RSV was a pediatric virus. But now we've learned it affects adults also. So as we have developed this information and as the vaccine has become available for people age 60 and older, we've had to do a big educational program to educate not only the public, but also practitioners that this is important. And this has influenced the uptake of the vaccine in this very first season in which it was available. There are other things going on, of course, at the same time. During this respiratory virus season, instead of just recommending influenza vaccine, we recommended, yes, influenza vaccine, also the updated COVID vaccine, and hey, for people age 60 and older, a new RSV vaccine. wow, got a little crowded there. And I think we as practitioners, as the persons who deliver this vaccine, have to get ourselves organized. We have to educate people about that. And we have to also hope that people will, as we educate them, begin to roll up their sleeves more than once in order to get these vaccines on a seasonal basis. So this first season has been rather a challenge as we try to get vaccine protection out to as many people as possible who are age 60 and older.
Since this is a new vaccine, how should we interpret these numbers? Because we look at 20% of those 60 and older have gotten an RSV shot. Is that a good accomplishment, given that this is the first time around? Or is there something else kind of going on here?
Well, I think we can give ourselves a B+. Obviously, the acceptance of any new vaccine is going to be cautious, both on the practitioner side and on the patient side. So the fact that we've gotten about 20% of people age 60 and older vaccinated is a good thing. We also, not to get too much into the weeds here, have to look at the nature of the recommendation for people age 60 and older. It's shared clinical decision-making. It's the CDC's Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices didn't say, give it to everyone age 60 and older, but they said, have a discussion with your patients about that. And that puts a caution light, kind of a yellow caution light in the minds of many practitioners. And it takes a little more work in order to have those discussions. But for sure, as I have said to patients, with increasing age, your risk of serious RSV infection just goes up. So the older you are, the stronger my recommendation. Also, older people have a tendency to accumulate chronic underlying medical conditions. And every time you add a condition, some heart disease, some lung disease, you know, high blood pressure, diabetes, obesity, whatever it is, your risk at that age takes a notch up. So as I have said to patients, even though you may be, let's say, 66, still relatively young, but if you have diabetes or you have high blood pressure, in addition to being age 66, then my recommendation to you to get the RSV vaccine becomes more imperative. Yes, I really think you ought to get it. As opposed to if you were 66 and still running marathons, I would say, well, you might consider it.
Lucky
and
you.
And so that has resulted in it's not being strongly recommended for everyone age 60 and older, but having given the vaccine this first year out to 20+% of the population age 60 and older, not bad.
It's funny, I am over 60 and I did have this discussion and my doctor, I don't have any underlying conditions. I'm 61 and she and I decided this year probably wasn't necessary. I've got COVID booster, I got the flu shot, but I didn't get the RSV vaccine. So it's interesting to hear you talk about that. I wasn't really thinking about it, that I'm not part of that 20% when we look at that number. So, you know, there's a personal anecdote. The other thing I wonder, though, is, have you seen, because all of the vaccines we're talking about are respiratory, COVID, the coronavirus, flu, and RSV, we have seen a slight rebound on flu vaccine uptake in the last couple of years after the pandemic. And the COVID numbers are just below 20%, I believe, for the latest numbers we've seen. Do you believe that the vaccine hesitancy or resistance, and we've seen some big people like RFK Jr., you know, that are anti-vax, is that having a lasting impact that is changing the nature of what we think about vaccines in America, or is it still a fairly small subset of people who buy into that?
Did you hear me sigh? Because I think the answer is yes, for sure. Let's look at the acceptance of the updated COVID vaccine. People have really wanted to put COVID behind them. And looking at the entire U.S. population, not just the older population, but we've only reached about 20% of the entire U.S. population that was basically 100% eligible for this vaccine. Yes, acceptance rises as you get older, and that's a very, very good thing. But the caution, the skepticism, the hesitancy, the wish to put COVID behind us really is strongly out there. And of course, not to go into this in any length, but there are political implications. There have been several studies to indicate now that politically red states are less well immunized, that's my home state in Tennessee, than are the bluer states, where immunization acceptance has been higher. So its hesitancy, for sure, is with us and will continue to be with us, so that all of us who are individual practitioners, infectious disease doctors, people in public health, we're going to have to listen to the population, respond to their concerns, and continue to promote the use of these vaccines. Because, as I like to say, reducing it to its essence, disease bad, vaccines good.
I did want to ask, you know, before you go, to put this, to put all of this in context, because, you know, for your entire career, you have been studying and trying to understand infectious diseases in the context of public health. And so if you were to kind of, you know, put a circle around this and look into your crystal ball, what is the state of public health right now? And should we be optimistic about the future of public health?
As a genetically optimistic person, I remain optimistic. If you're interested in public health, which is dedicated to the betterment of health in the population, you've got to be an optimist, which doesn't mean that there isn't a struggle. And you have to persist in trying to provide the best information, but beyond information, a sense of comfort, a sense that getting vaccinated is reasonable and it's the responsible thing to do, not only for yourself, but for those around you. Remember, these are communicable infections we're trying to prevent, so we don't want to put others at risk. No one wants to be a dreaded spreader, right? And so I think we're going to have to continue to listen, respond, persist, and be optimistic, but we'll have to continue to be energetic going forward in promoting vaccines. You know, looking forward, medical science is going to provide even more opportunities to prevent more diseases through vaccines as we move through this very exciting century. So let's not backslide now as we're also simultaneously moving forward.
Dr. William Schaffner, Professor of Infectious Diseases at Vanderbilt University School of Medicine, thank you so very much for joining us today. We very much appreciate your insight and knowledge.
It's been my very great pleasure to be with you. Thank you.
Well, is it the reduced price or the earlier hour that has the early bird special appealing to younger Americans? According to new research, Gen Z between the ages of 15 and 34 are skipping last call and opting for a few extra hours of sleep. According to a survey of about 2 million customers from the company Sleep Number, Americans within this age group are getting an average of 9 hours and 12 minutes of sleep per night. Other data shows that they're making dinner reservations earlier than ever at about 5 p.m., and they're also bringing back some old school habits. So, Lee, sadly, neither you nor I fit this age group or this demographic. So let's open it up to Athen and to Rebecca. What is going on here?
I would say I, as someone that's in that age group in Gen Z, I think it's just like the amount, maybe the amount of stress or the amount of things that we feel like we have to do now with like going to school, working a job at the same time, having the amount of extracurriculars you have to get into the work field. Maybe it's just out of exhaustion that we're going to bed earlier and eating dinner earlier.
Rebecca, what do you think?
I was just going to interrupt. Rebecca, just one second. I just got to interrupt right there. Athen, if it's exhaustion that's making you sleep later, I would be, you know, sleeping 12 hours a night. So now, Rebecca, you jump.
I can't say that I relate to sleeping later and eating earlier. Sure. If I'm honest, I'm going to bed after midnight almost every single night, and I eat when I can, honestly, but that's kind of the nature of being on campus. I think sometimes some of our free time is only at night. A lot of clubs meet at 9:15, so I might be getting home after that and eating dinner at 10 p.m., and that's just what it is. But I do see a lot of people trying to get to bed sooner rather than later, and I think that it is kind of college classes, internships, jobs, having to get up by 8 or 9 to show up to work.
So are weekends for you guys times to catch up on your sleeping, or is that the time to catch up on your entertainment?
It's a bit of both. I work on the weekends personally, so I'm still working on Saturdays.
Well, here's a question, though, because when you think about more people working remotely, is this more a convenience factor? You know, when you think about, you don't have to necessarily leave the office or leave a location to make dinner, you know, at a later time. You know, you're sort of wrapping things up. There's a little bit more flexibility at home or on campus or in the dorm room, you know, to meet friends and other people for an earlier dinner. What do you think? Lee, even, you know, from your experience, you've been working remotely too since the pandemic, not fully, but a few days here or there.
I don't fit into any of this. I'm a night owl. I wish I could sleep later in the morning, so I sort of squeeze it. Dinner comes in, I don't know, I don't think I've eaten dinner before 5 o'clock, and I can't remember. I probably would call that lunch if it was like at 4 o'clock. So just you have to turn all the hours back. Maybe I'm in the wrong time zone. I don't know. But Mary, I was going to turn it on to you.
Uh-oh.
Okay, you have work, family, kids. How does that all work out?
I would kill to get 9 hours of sleep a night. Are you kidding me? No, but I mean, I've always been sort of an old soul. I think Lee, you and Barb have always called me that in the many years that I've known you. And, you know, I mean, I think that for the shift, you know, following COVID of having a little more flexibility, I know that it's can be a little bit easier sometimes to sort of log off at 5 or 5:30 and then, you know, get to, you know, run out to a meeting or to be able to have dinner because there is a little bit more air in the schedule, so to speak, you know, in terms of location. Getting out to an earlier dinner does help sometime when you reduce the commute. But one piece of information that I found really fascinating is this idea of members of Gen Z being interested in some of these sort of more classical interests, shall we say, like listening to jazz. You know, that I thought was really interesting, really cool. And Rebecca, have you seen that with your peers, that there are types of perhaps interests that harken back to older days, shall we say?
Yeah, I would say so. I'd say especially in music, I think that a lot of people are listening to genres that some people might have thought were kind of bygone. I think that jazz is having kind of a resurgence, even with modern artists. I believe Lofi is how you say her name. She's a really popular jazz artist right now. Me personally, I'm a fan of Chet Baker. I listen to Chet Baker almost every single day. I think that you know, even more recent decades of music are becoming popular again. I think people are interested in Fleetwood Mac today in a really real way, and ABBA and kind of bygone eras like that.
Well, that's painful when you say bygone eras.
You're making me into a dinosaur right now.
Well, ABBA just put out new music.
That is true.
Years ago. So who knows?
How about you, Athens? Where's this breakdown for you? I have another comment, but I first wanted to pick you up on this.
Yeah, I don't know if I'm seeing as much of a popularity with jazz, but I feel like kind of the old school hobbies are definitely coming back. I feel like a lot of people I know in their free time are taking up things like knitting or crocheting or things like that, where they're kind of like old school hobbies where you're just sitting down and doing things by hand. So I think I definitely see that a lot.
Wow.
No, it's interesting. My mom and my grandmother had, well, like my grandmother when she was living, my mom now, she crochets, and I never got into it. And she would always say to me when I would be going through like a stressful time, you really need to take up something like crocheting or needlepoint to sort of occupy, you know, my brain to de-stress. So I wonder if there's something
that's playing into it in some way, shape, or form.
Here's what I'm upset about. So if we're going back to like jazz and old hobbies, why are not movies also part of that? So I'm always talking to students. I know old movies, like, you know, right now are not what I consider old movies. But when I think of black and white movies, those are what I call old movies. And I always ask students, I even threaten they're not going to graduate. I don't think you should get your diploma unless you've seen Casablanca, for example. And, and I'm just pushing that. The Maltese Falcon, I think, is a biggie. Gaslight. These are things that I don't know how you can be an educated person, well-educated, without seeing these. But from what I'm hearing from you younger people is that this is not part of the kickback to olden times. You're not digging deep into the history. Why not? Okay, give me an answer. Why not?
I don't know if it's much of like a going back and listening to like old jazz as it is younger people are making like new versions of jazz. So I don't know if people are going back and watching like old black and white movies, or if it's like the younger people that are getting into film are making recreations or like different versions of those type of movies.
Okay. All right. So I stand corrected. That was a very clever out you just took on that. You nuanced me out of my attack. What a great defense. All right. You can graduate.
Thank you. It's a good thing it's only a few months away.
Rebecca, how about you?
I mean, I personally, now and then, I'm watching some old movies. I mean, my dad's a big movie buff, big film buff. But I think that maybe in the age of Letterboxd, if you know what that is, an app where people are tracking the movies they're watching, I think in the age of Letterboxd, maybe people are going to return to some classics. I think that people want to be cultured in that way. But at the same time, I do know of people who have seen more classic movies trying to build up their film repertoire, and they haven't liked them. They thought that they were boring, unfortunately. I hate to report.
So, Lee, I know you like to have the last word in segments, but why don't we Rebecca and Nathan have the last word on this one. What is your take on why members of your generation are calling it earlier night?
I think it's just like maybe we value sleep more. I don't know. I know personally I can't start the day without at least 8 hours of sleep. So I unfortunately fit in this category.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't think that I really do fit in this category very well, but I will say that when I do get my sleep, I do love it.
Okay, so now we pivot into something I think we are probably going to all have a comment on, and perhaps one that we view together. We're going to welcome back in Jay and Barbara into the discussion as well on this. And this is our fun fact, of course. And CBS News in January of 2015 asked the question, which one of the following is your favorite pizza topping? Onions, pepperoni, sausage, mushrooms, pepperoni, 45%, almost a majority. I think this is something we could all weigh in on. I'm going to start with Barb in the upper right. What's your pizza preference?
Well, I thought it was interesting that 3% of Americans don't eat pizza. And I could understand why, because there's a lot of cheese. And certainly, even if you're not a fond of cheese, some of us who love it can't take it in the quantities we used to. And 4% actually couldn't decide on an answer. And maybe it was because their favorite topping wasn't one of the choices.
There.
For me, I hate to say it, but I don't like any toppings on my pizza. I am your basic, you know, tomato bread and mozzarella cheese kind of gal. And you can change that around as just a, you know, kind of a standard pizza or the traditional margarita and throw a little basil on there too. But I'm awfully traditional on this one.
Jay, you are the one who very often challenges the categories of choices on these. And I know Barb said, well, maybe not everybody's pick is being offered here. What's your favorite? And I have a funny feeling you go with toppings. I just think you're a toppings guy. I don't.
Wow, no, the opposite. And I am a little surprised that they didn't go with a bunch of crazy toppings, considering how many of these polls that we bring into the fun fact where they'd ask, you know, would you put like, I don't know, like anchovies? Why are anchovies not on the list, right? I mean,
peppers,
or pineapple.
Peppers
or pineapple and Canadian bacon, all these crazy things. You know, that would have, I think, had some fun results. No, I'm with Barb. My favorite pizza ever was a place on Bleecker and 7th Avenue, and they did a Nonna Maria by the slice. And nobody knows by the slice. Super thin crust, super hot oven, super thin crust with a little cornmeal on the bottom. But then a chunky fresh tomato sauce they made every day, fresh moots, and then basil leaves. Done. Done. I like pepperoni. I'm not going to lie. But I don't like the ones all loaded up. Like, that's a salad. It's not a pizza.
Salad on bread. Mary, I want to know about you and I want to know about your kids also.
Okay, so I'm with Barb and with Jay. I like the just traditional pizza. I will, if we do have a topping, I will go with pepperoni. That's my standard. My husband and kids like meatball. I do like the occasional veggie slice and barbecue chicken pizza. Then, of course, you could always get into, yeah, I know, crazy, Jay. Every once in a while with the barbecue sauce instead of the tomato sauce. But my kids and my husband do like the pasta on top of pizza, which is a little bit overkill. So there's like a ziti slice. Come to my neighborhood. You have to try it. But for me, it's really just the traditional.
Well, we just finished talking about what younger generations are doing in terms of sleep and entertainment. So let's see if they also join the no toppings crowd with our pizza selection. So let's go to Athan and Rebecca.
I'm going to have to say I'm the exact opposite. I like a lot of toppings. I don't usually get just cheese. I don't eat meat, so I usually would do like onions, peppers, olives, mushrooms. Like, but I'm surprised they didn't put any more controversial ones like pineapple, because that's also something I put on pizza. I feel like the more toppings, the more I like it.
The more you're on the podcast, the more I realize we don't agree with anything. It's amazing. Do you like a sunny day or a rainy day, for example? Rebecca, what do you think?
Well, I got to say, I'm pretty surprised by a lot of these results on here. I'm surprised that mushrooms is at 23%. I didn't realize that many people were getting mushrooms on pizza. I personally do like toppings on my pizza. My favorite pizza topping is onions. I'm in the minority here of the topping choices.
6%.
At 6%, but yeah. I do love onions in my pizza, but I'm in the same camp as Athan. I'm not really getting meat on my pizza. I'm loading it up with a lot of veggies. I love a veggie slice. I love a slice that's basically a salad, as Jay says.
Fair enough. Fair enough.
Well, at the Marist poll, politics and pizza are a staple. I think most of the ones we get don't have toppings, although I'm not totally sure about that. I know that I take the ones that don't have the toppings. How's that? Well, around the horn we went, and we'll know to avoid certain things, but plain is still very much in vogue.
When the moon hits your eye like a big pizza pie, that's amore.
That'll do it for Poll Hut this week. Poll Hub is produced by the Marist Poll at Marist College in Poughkeepsie, New York.
Mary Griffith is our executive producer. Casey Schaff is our production supervisor.
The Poll Hub team includes Athan Hollis and Rebecca Hendricks.
If you enjoy Poll Hub, please consider leaving a review.
Positive reviews help other listeners like you find us.
If you'd like to learn more about polling and survey science, check out the Marist Poll Academy, our free online learning portal.
If you have questions for us, tweet them at us at Marist Poll.
Remember, you can always tell your smart speaker to play Poll Hub.
And with any luck, it'll cooperate.
Finally, wherever you listen to Poll Hub, there is a subscribe button.
Click it and the latest episode will be ready for you and your podcasting app as soon as it's released.
We'll see you next time.
But you know you're not dreaming, signore. Excuse me, but you see, back in old Napoli, that's amore.